and thank you for joining us. I'm Manisha Gupta, Group Product Manager with Google Cloud Networking. We are here today to discuss a topic that is of importance to every telecom provider: managing and defending against the escalating and diverse cyber threat landscape. And I'm joined today by Phil Kealy. Phil is a leader in our Mandiant Incident Response Team with over 10 years of responding to cyber breaches and incidents at Mandiant. Phil has previously led security programs within the federal government and critical infrastructure prior to joining Mandiant and now Google. Phil, thank you for joining us today.
Yeah, thanks. And it's great to be here. This is definitely a topic that I'm really passionate about.
So Phil, as we all know, telecom networks are the very backbone of any country, connecting everything. So let's start with what makes telecom networks such a prime target for adversaries. What kind of attacks are we looking at? And why are telecom networks particularly difficult to defend?
Telecoms are truly the backbone of critical infrastructure for their communications. First, their services are always expected to be on. Everybody relies on these networks in some way, shape, or form throughout their day-to-day. Next, they have a lot of high-value data and sensitive data. Some of this data includes customer information, which can include data that can be used to distinguish or trace an individual's identity. Telecoms also manage and provide the communication networks, including data and voice for every company and organization I mentioned before, companies, governments, individuals. And finally, telecom networks are vast. They are complex. They're sprawling. They incorporate diverse technology stacks, 5G, satellite, voice, other networking elements that are unique only to their environments.
Phil, thanks for that glimpse into some of the traits that are so unique to telecom providers. It sounds like they attract numerous threat groups based on the types of data they maintain and the requirement that they have to be always on. So Phil, nearly every organization seems to be a target of these financially motivated threat actors. But the impact potential seems to be very high for the telecom providers.
Yeah.
So what about other threat actors?
Yeah, surely. Now, outside of financially motivated threat actors, the one that I'm going to focus on the most today is the advanced persistent threat actor. Because telecom providers maintain or transmit a lot of sensitive information, they are truly a target of those particular type of threat actors, advanced persistent threat, or APT threat actors. These are nation-state adversaries that are well-funded, that are very persistent, and will try to target you over months, years, and decades. APT actors are specifically interested in subscriber data, client information, and also the communications that may be traversing a telecoms network. As we saw recently in telecoms, they may also contain lawful intercept information. This is where law enforcement agencies can legally monitor communications on a network. And as you can imagine, this data is very valuable as it may contain the individuals or phone numbers that are being targeted by the lawful intercept systems. And attackers could even target these systems to try to obtain the captured information or leverage them to target the communications of specific individuals.
That's very well said, Phil. Now let me talk about one particular threat, the Salt Typhoon cyber attack. Yeah. It was revealed late in 2024. Reportedly compromised the networks of at least 9 major US telecom providers, and it reportedly accessed sensitive communications data. So from your perspective, what made Salt Typhoon campaign particularly insidious and impactful for telecom operators? And how does such a sophisticated state-sponsored attack underscore the urgent need for telecom providers to move towards autonomous operations to achieve that ultra-fast detection and response capabilities to protect themselves?
First, what I'm going to do is dive into that particular threat actor. So Salt Typhoon is the public name that many organizations know this threat actor by. Mandiant tracks this threat cluster as the uncategorized or UNC group 5807. This group is a sophisticated espionage group that has demonstrated a very deep understanding of the telco environments and networks. Ultimately, as in many of our nation-state sponsored threat groups, their objective is long-term access, data exfiltration, and surveillance. This makes them a significant national security concern, And specifically, we have seen them target a couple things of note. One, the communications of high-level political or government officials. As previously mentioned, some of the call records and lawful intercept programs. Obviously, this data is very useful for espionage activities. And again, given some of the unique positions of the telecom providers as critical infrastructure, as well as the repositories of sensitive data, the impact of Salt Typhoon and the compromise can be severe. So impact national security, some of the operational continuity, and then also customer trust, ultimately. And this is really where Mandiant's Incident Response Services and my team and some of the global teams that are out there become invaluable. We've tracked extensively Salt Typhoon's tactics, techniques, and procedures, or something called TTPs. These organizations, or Salt Typhoon, is known for a few specific TTPs. First, they exploit public-facing applications and network devices. They live off the land. And many times when we think about living off the land, this is really on a Windows system or some system that's going to run EDR. In these cases, Salt Typhoon is actually abusing other systems and using legitimate means to access those systems, to move laterally, and then also escalate privileges on those targets. The target systems, they don't support that typical endpoint detection and response capability, EDR. And those systems really lack codified detection mechanisms. Additionally to that, we have observed in a very small number of cases the deployment of custom backdoors. These threat actors try to not deploy anything that's going to look malicious or potentially get detected by security software.
Could you elaborate a little bit more on what makes Mandiant so uniquely equipped to defend telecom providers, specifically against an adversary like Salt Typhoon that's so persistent and elusive?
When I went back and looked it up, we have worked collectively as Mandiant over 25,000 hours just in the last year to help telecom organizations respond to and secure against this type of advanced threat. So if I look at Salt Typhoon, really in the face of this type of adversary, you do need that robust an intelligence-driven incident response capability. And Mandiant can not only help you, like my team does on the incident response side, to respond to that breach, but hopefully we can help you be more resilient so that way you don't have to call in my team.
That's really impressive. Are there any particular stories from responding to this threat actor that would be meaningful to share?
One of the stories that I'm thinking of is our teams really had to build out the methodologies to obtain forensic evidence and memory images from a lot of different types of network devices and elements. So if you think about typical playbooks, you can easily take and get forensic images from a Windows system, a Linux system, but these wouldn't work in this case. And the team spent a lot of time in those data centers, those telco closets, and other outposts, if you may, that, again, we just couldn't have imagined we would have visited.
Yeah, very interesting. And, you know, coming from networking, I can totally understand how difficult it is to just get access to some of those facilities, let alone, you know, get data from there. So let's talk a little bit about some of the Mandiant services that your team offers, some of the different types of engagements, how customers engage with Mandiant, and how do they get access to the services that you offer.
Yeah, for sure. Mandiant has a lot of different services to help architect a more resilient network, battle test those networks, improve on overall detections, and more. As breaches are inevitable, and because I'm an incident response leader, I'll start with the Mandiant Retainer. So what the Mandiant Retainer does is that takes care of all the contracting components in advance and ensures you have the right expertise on speed dial in case you need help. You get access to our 24/7 hotline, as well as our on-call responders to enable that rapid triage and initial scoping. Additionally, this team, as I've been talking about, is really that intel-led component. We have more insight into what these threat actors are doing to really drive that forensic response as well as those key containment activities. Additionally, we've also already discussed that we understand a lot of the complexities of telecommunication networks. And this includes the core infrastructure, to edge devices, as well as their customer-facing services. And then one of the things with Salt Typhoon is many organizations and just the general public think of it as a U.S.-centric incident or threat actor. But ultimately, that isn't the case. We as Mandiant, we've responded to breaches that are for telco environments around the world. So I do want to note that we have global reach. We have local presence with experts in over 30 countries. So we can really provide that global coordination and provide that crucial in-region support, particularly with some of the items and stories I was talking about for actually physically having to handle some of those devices.
So Phil, a follow-up question on that. We've heard a lot about Mandiant's incident response services, and you know, you've shared a lot more with us today. But what about some of the other pre-breach or non-emergency services that we offer?
First, one of the ones that we have, which we've seen a lot of interest in, is what's called the Mandiant Custom Threat Hunt. What this does is even without an active incident, we can take all of that intelligence that we have, all of the frontline information that my team has, and we can come into an environment and say, hey, what technology do you have? What threat actors are going to target you? And perform very targeted threat hunting to identify any sort of presence of a particular threat actor, as well as weaknesses either within your security logging or your environment that could be exploited. Some of the other ones that we've seen just on the tail end of this is really that security architecture review, which is going to come in and we will look at your architecture, work with you to identify some of those gaps in your security posture, and ultimately focus on those areas that Salt Typhoon would target, which particularly those are going to be network device configurations, your identity and access management, and this is both the front door, but also your administrative access, and then some of your supply chain security. And then the last two are probably going to be tabletop exercises. You got to practice. You can take and talk about this, but until you walk through this end-to-end, either from a technical perspective or an executive perspective, you really can't understand how you're going to respond and how you're going to respond under stress. So we can take and test your incident response plans and identify areas for improvement. And then the last one is really going to be red teaming and attacker simulation. So for attacker simulation, we can come in and emulate or simulate a specific threat actor. What this allows us to do is take and say, hey, you're a telco and provider, let's see if you are resilient against these specific TTPs.
That's really impressive and very comprehensive, Phil, and a lot of information to process. These are tactics of hiding in plain sight in such a large-scale environment as a telecom providers. And it sounds quite challenging to protect against and defend against, and ultimately investigate these type of threats. So pivoting slightly, I know AI continues to be a hot topic in cybersecurity landscape. Can you tell us a little bit on how Mandiant is leveraging AI to perform some of these actions and delivering results and outcomes and investigations faster?
Yeah, surely. And I've been getting this question a lot lately. How is Mandiant using AI? AI has come a long way in the last year. And we continue to evolve our use cases for our internal teams. Before I dive into some of those use cases, I do want to note that during an incident, Mandiant many times has to operate only in a client security stack as well as their environment. So what this means is from some of the AI components that we have access to on the back end at Google with SecOps and other tools, we may not be able to leverage. But if a client has that technology already deployed, we can use it. So for telcos, a couple direct examples that I can think of from our engagements. One, as we come into a telecommunication environment, they may have devices that nobody else in the world has. There's no reason to have network devices of this particular type or size. So understanding that atypical or bespoke logging data set is something that we could use AI to better inform and inform quickly. Additionally, if you're going to analyze this particular type of log source, you need to write code or parsers to help ingest it or process it. So we can use AI to help us on on processing it or how we're going to parse that out into a meaningful format to our team. And then another one that came up, which was quite interesting, was really around parsing and explaining configurations from routers, switches, and other network elements. And you know, in most organizations, this isn't going to be impactful because in many enterprises, those are fairly straightforward. But in network and telecom industries, they're very complex. You know, you compare that to what you would normally see within an enterprise environment, it may be an order of magnitude bigger and more difficult to actually understand. And then finally, and this one kind of goes back to the first item, for some of these devices, just because we don't see them very often, we can take and distill that vendor documentation so that we can understand the use cases of those devices, some of how telecoms may be using those, so that way we can get quickly ramped up on how we can investigate them. And then finally, right, the cool part is how are we going to use AI to analyze some of this? And this is where I'd see a lot of security teams kind of pivoting to, is to move to natural language questions to actually enable asking questions of that data. Is it normal for this administrator to log in this many times? Where all have they logged in from? So you can start to baseline those log sets as well as search those log sets. So that's some of them that we've seen. Ultimately, I'd say this did speed us up substantially. I'd say probably 70% less time on a lot of those tasks that we spend. And it ultimately sped up our ability to get to that analytical part to try to provide answers very quickly.
Well, 70% reduction means 70% faster response to an incident when it occurs means better security and better defenses for any operator.
Yeah.
That's impressive. Phil, that was incredibly insightful. Thank you. It's clear that the threat landscape for telecom providers is more challenging than ever. Sophisticated, state-sponsored threats like Salt Typhoon, they demand a fundamentally new approach to cybersecurity. And reiterating what you said, the question is not if an incident will occur, but when. And when it occurs, the operators need to be able to respond to it quickly and effectively. I can tell that with all of Mandiant's experience in telecom environments, that Mandiant is the industry leader in not just containing breaches, but also building that true resilience that telecom networks need. Phil, thank you again for sharing your knowledge with us and your expertise.
It was an absolute pleasure being here today. Staying ahead of these sophisticated threats and protecting critical infrastructure like telecom networks requires constant innovation and constant collaboration. We as Mandiant and myself, we look forward to continuing to do our part in protecting this critical space. Thank you.